And now, here's Darrell.
Well, I'm waiting for the music to go off in the background. It's a pleasure to welcome you to our first cultural engagement chapel of the fall. For those of you who are new students, let me tell you how this works. This is part of the cultural engagement initiative of the Hendricks Center, and we do four chapels a year on a variety of topics related to God and culture. It's an extension of the Table podcast that you can find out about at www.ets.edu/thetable. I say that in my sleep. And what way this will work is I'm going to interview our two experts, and we'll introduce the topic here in a second, on something for about 10 or 15 minutes. And then you'll see the microphones in the aisles there. You're going to be free to ask questions of this august group over here to my right. And our topic is a simple one today. We did a conference yesterday called Jerusalem Meets Vegas, on sexual choices and issues of sexual identity in Christian community. And I think it's fair to say that one of the most challenging pastoral problems that a pastor faces in the church is working through the tension of where our society is in areas of sexuality, and particularly with regard to same-sex issues, and setting a tone in the congregation for biblical standards and approaches to that question, and keeping a hand extended in ministering to individuals who may show up in their church who need the Lord. So how do you put those two things together? How do you minister in that context? That's what we're going to be discussing. My guests are on the far right, my far right, is Mark Yarhouse, Professor of Psychology and Director for the Institute for the Study of Sexual Identity at Regent University in Virginia. And Mark has written a series of books in this area. He's probably recognized as one of the foremost evangelical spokespeople on this topic globally. And then Stan Jones, to his left and my right in the middle here, is Provost and Professor of Psychology at Wheaton College, who also has worked in this area a long time, has written a lot about it, and is recognized as one of the world's evangelical experts on this topic. So I got two experts here, and so I'm just going to interact with them, and we'll see how it goes. Stan, yesterday at the conference, cited a quotation from Time magazine in 1966 that portrayed very vividly how homosexual lifestyle was viewed in 1966 as really a mental illness, and no other way to describe the citation. And the point that he was making is, look where we've come since 1966 in terms of the way society views this area. We've done a complete turnaround, basically, in terms of how the area is seen. And that adjustment in the way the culture has viewed the area has put terrific pressure on churches in thinking through this and in dealing with this, given the biblical background of what it is that we also face. So yesterday, in one of the points that was made, Mark Yarhouse made the point about what he called a realistic biblical hope, how to deal in ministry in this area and how to reach out to people. And there really are three ways of going at this, as he outlined them. One is to deal and emphasize the need for healing in terms of patterns of attraction. The other is to deal with working on a change of identity, how someone sees themselves. And the third is what might be called faithful vocation, a recognition that maybe someone's attractions don't change, but how they choose to live it out can be dealt with. So those are the three areas, and those three areas tend to be seen in conflict with one another. So Mark, what advice would you give us as we think through the various ways that people even approach the issue of dealing with same-sex attraction as a matter of counseling and that kind of thing? What would you say about that?
Yeah, well, let me just first say thank you for having me and including me in this chapel, and for your attendance today. What I was trying to show was what I see in what I would call the ministry landscape that I see in Christian circles. And what they hold in common is that the ministries share a sexual ethic that says same-sex behavior is not morally permissible. Mm-hmm. So they're on the same page theologically in that sense. But what you see are people clustering with a different message for the person who's navigating this terrain. And on the one group, you have this message of more dramatic healing or transformation, change. This would be kind of the language that they would feel most comfortable with. And there are individuals who would say, this is my testimony. God brought me out of something I was steeped in. I was participating in a pattern of behavior that characterized me over time, and I've left that. And some in that context would declare a feelings of attraction now to the opposite sex that they feel is a part of their testimony. So there's this group of people. And then there's another cluster of ministry that would be, would have wanted that, but didn't experience that kind of dramatic change, that kind of maybe miraculous or, you know, kind of a testimony. But theirs is a movement away from identity. They don't see themselves the way they used to. They used to be steeped in a gay identity and a culture, and they've said no to that. Their changes that are dramatic might be more behavioral. And these are meaningful changes for them as well. And it could correspond with a lessening of the strength of their attractions, but it doesn't have the corresponding increase in attraction, you know, to the opposite sex. Then the third group is this group that, as I talk with them, would have liked those experiences as well, and often tried to have those experiences in many cases, not all. But they have come to the conclusion that their attraction patterns are not going to diminish, they're not going to change. And so it's more like some would reference Paul's discussion of a thorn in the flesh. They've asked for it to be removed. It's not been removed. And now they're looking for meaning and purpose in the context of more of a besetting condition, enduring condition. So what is it going to look like for me to treat this more vocationally? And as one person I know who wrote about this said, you know, vocations like this, most of them aren't chosen. It's not like I choose my vocation. Many of the vocations that I experience in my life are due to the circumstances I find myself in, and God is sovereign over that and provides for me. And so that's this group, I think, that's living out more of a life of celibacy in a cultural context in which that just seems so such an impossible consideration today.
Let me work with some ironies out of this. One of the ironies is no matter which one of those three paths are taken, those who are committed to a gay lifestyle don't like any of those solutions, do they?
Well, they disagree with the sexual ethic that's represented underneath all. I think there's maybe a little more curiosity and regard for the celibacy one. Mm-hmm. What they don't like is when it's proclaimed as a position that others have to adhere to, when it's prescribed. There's a little bit of, well, you can do what you want. That's not something I would choose to do. No, that kind of a tone. But I think anybody who chooses to submit themselves to an authority, who recognizes transcendent reality and submits themselves to an authority that resides outside of their own impulses and desires, I think that in our culture today is not just suspect, but is often treated with great consternation.
And then the other irony that comes with this, of course, is that these three approaches tend to battle with each other a little bit in terms of which is the one.
I think so. That's my observation in the Christian community of ministry. I would love to see these ministries demonstrate greater regard for one another and respect for each other. What I tend to observe is not that, a little bit more of a, here's where you're missing the mark to one another. And there is a sense in which we should, I think, challenge each other and be mutually edifying. I don't get that tone from the discussions that I see right now.
Yeah. Okay, let's shift, Stan, and I want to ask you about this. The core tension that I see for people in ministry is, and it's a very practical one, is the tension between trying to reach out to people and bring them into into an interaction with the living God and the way he can change and transform people at whatever level that we've just gone through, along and setting a community tone. How do you put those two together? In other words, the tension between the demands of individual ministry and individual counseling and being open and available and helpful and shepherding, if you will, and a responsibility a pastor has to set a community tone for what the community represents. How do you deal with that tension?
I would urge us all to look again and again and again at the model of Jesus Christ himself in terms of being one who was very fearless in the proclamation of truth and harsh at times and forceful in the proclamation of truth, but one who at the same time was known as one who affiliated with prostitutes and the outcast and so forth. And so somehow he set that tone of a constant engagement. And we're in a very perplexing place because On the one hand, I think that the church has been guilty, truly guilty, of imbibing stereotypes about gay and lesbian people, about assuming that they're the worst of the worst, and has been dismissive and hurtful and harsh in its rhetoric. We have been so engaged with the culture wars that we've set up that dilemma and responded that way, and not realized that these are people sitting in our pews. And at the same time, on the big front, so we've been guilty, but at the same time, there's elements of the gay advocacy community that have seen quite deliberately that there's political power in posturing ourselves as victims, and so to, in a sense, wear our victimization on our sleeve, and really use that as a weapon to silence people, and so taking a front at every possible element and so forth and so on is there. So this makes it very delicate to walk down this path. But I think that the church has to, on the one hand, have moral clarity about the sexual morality that it proclaims. And so I think part of what it means to proclaim the truth is to be clear that, as Mark said, that we have to conclude from Scripture that Scripture does not condone same-sex intimacy as a path that God would approve. So that needs to be part of our message. But I think it shouldn't be the front plate of what we present to the world, to the gay and lesbian world. We need instead to have that same spirit of Christ where we're reaching out to engage in friendship, build common bonds wherever we can, find ways to serve the gay and lesbian community, serve individual gays and lesbians, have them in our houses, invite them to our churches. And I think at first of being able to share the person of Christ with such individuals. As I spoke yesterday, I also think that the church needs to be much more prepared to speak of a broader positive vision of sexuality. That for many evangelicals, for many biblically conservative Christians, sexuality is a series of no's, no's, no's. Don't do this, don't do this, don't do this. And we don't have a broader comprehensive vision of the gift of sexuality, the blessing of sexuality, the pervasiveness of sexuality, the goodness of sexuality, the way that sexuality is a part of the ways in which we image God. Whether we're married and have families or are single, we have the opportunity to image God. And so if we have those things prepared, then I think that we can engage constructively the individual and gay and lesbian community. But I think inevitably there's going to be tensions because many people will perceptibly say, no, but I want to know where you stand morally. Mm-hmm. And in some ways, I think we should try to hold off that conversation as long as we can. I think we should say, let me tell you about Christ. Let me tell you about the positive image of sexuality. Let me also tell you the way that we are all pervasively broken. So we need to break through that posture where you know, I'm the person who's healthy. You're the person who's broken. Let me lead you to the light, but rather to say, I'm a fellow beggar. I'm a fellow broken person. I'm a fellow person in search of healing. I found in Christ the answer to my life, the answer to how I can be whole in God, and I want to invite you into that same kind of relationship.
Now, obviously, we are not going to be able to solve this problem in our half hour here, but there's another element to this conversation that I think is important that grows out of it, and that is the role and the value of singleness and affirming singleness in the midst of of this conversation. It fits in with the having a positive view of sexuality and also a positive view of identity. So let's talk a little bit about that. How has the church created a problem for itself in dealing with singleness, and why is that important to this discussion? And while I'm asking that question, the mics are open. If you have a question, feel free to approach a mic, and we'll start asking questions here and just answering questions in just a second.
Well, I think in many, many churches, the singles group is a place to fix singleness. It is the place for people to make connections and get out of that state, which in part, there's a part of that with which there's nothing wrong, because for many of us, our heart's desire is to find a person with whom we can experience life union, and life union in marriage is a tremendous blessing. But singleness is a condition that is blessed by God as well. Jesus Christ lived a single life and was the image of God, the best, purest, perfect image of God that ever lived. The Apostle Paul lived a single life. They both commend singleness. They commend it as a vocation for service. And I think that evangelicals, perhaps in part of a reaction against some of the excesses of the Catholic Church over time, have seen a high valuing of singleness as that Catholic thing, and so we've distanced ourselves, and we have not filled that void with a Protestant vision of what it means to be single and to be single, to be profitably, healthily single. And so we get concerned when single people have too close a friendship. We're worried about what's going to happen to them. We want them to find a romantic relationship. We want them to fit in. And so sometimes we can over-focus on the family, if I can put it that way, and not esteem singleness. And we don't fully integrate singles into our families. So we need to find ways to do that. You've had a lot of discussions about this.
Yeah, I mean, I would agree that most of our just practical church programming towards singles sends them the message that they're on the second tier rather than the top tier of the church in terms of having a robust and full role and purpose in the local church. And I think that sends a message to singles, period. But then imagine that you're a single person who's navigating these questions of sexual identity. The message that you receive is, well, you need to become heterosexual with the capacity to marry and have children to really be a full member of the body of Christ. And that's just, we just have to think about this. Is that really the message we intend to send to people who are navigating this terrain? And is that a likely outcome for them? You know, my view is I don't think it's a likely outcome for them. So you want to make the body of Christ a place where everybody who's a faithful follower of Christ can feel that they're a part of a true body, a family, a kinship network where we love each other and hold each other in great esteem, and we're journeying towards greater spiritual maturity together.
And so what that means, Mark, is that the person who, as you, I love this phrase, is navigating this terrain, the person who says, I'm going to be faithful, I'm going to walk with Christ, I'm going to remain single and celibate and be committed to Him, that's a good place to land, isn't it?
I think it is. I think the language here is difficult for many Protestants. The concept of celibacy is difficult. We have to remember we're in a sexually saturated culture where we essentially think of sexuality in terms of sexual self-actualization. So this is a pretty foreign idea within our cultural context. And our churches also, it's a foreign idea within many of our churches for someone to live into a celibate life. And we'll have many more, I think, heterosexuals who will be single than we will ever have people navigating this terrain who will be single. And so what we do with this is a larger question than just a response to homosexuality, as important as that is. But we'll be looking at this for how do we support one another being faithful. Stan's point earlier about the intimacy with the same sex, like that's not something for us to fear. Let me plug one book that I know is coming out next year, but Wesley Hill is writing a book on spiritual friendship where he is looking at the history of spiritual friendships over the church history and pointing out that we are we have lost the kind of intimacy that used to be a part of what it means to be brothers in Christ and sisters in Christ. And at the same time, we've seen a corresponding rise in a gay rights movement that's probably made us more fearful of that kind of intimacy. And we've lost what was once so characteristic of the church.
Could I add a quick note to make this personal? I've really been, a significant part of my writing career has been devoted to defending the possibility that people can change. And I've been really working against the absolute that's been thrown out by the American Psychological Association and others, that change is impossible. So I do believe strongly that change is possible. But I must say, the longer I'm in this area, the more modest I am in terms of the claims of the change that's possible. And for me, this is really personal. Almost 5 years ago, I had a doctor's appointment that I don't wish for anybody, where a neurologist sits across from you and says, you have an incurable, progressive, debilitating disease, Parkinson's disease, and it's going to steadily get worse. It may be slow, it may be fast, and this is sobering. And so I have a group of faithful friends that have gathered around me to pray and support me, and my progression has been blessedly slow, but it has progressed, and I'm slowly seeing more symptoms of the disease. Well, 2 years ago, one of my most faithful prayer warriors on this team, a woman who's a very dear friend of my wife and I, was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, which is a death sentence. And she was given 6 to 9 months to live. And so we joined in praying for her, and she sought out a lot of prayer, but she also sought out cutting-edge sort of treatment at the University of Chicago, and she got a clinical trial, you know, literally state-of-the-art science and so forth and so on. Well, along the way, they actually ceased the clinical trial because they realized it wasn't working for anybody, and they also realized that through genetic testing, there's no way it would work for her. And she is still alive 2 years later. Mm-hmm. She recently had a meeting with her neurologist, with her oncologist, and he said, you know, I've seen thousands of cases. You are in a category by yourself. Mm-hmm. Her tumor is a third the size that it was upon diagnosis. It appears to be dead. Mm-hmm. Her pancreas appears to be restarting. Mm-hmm. So, now, I celebrate her. I must confess, in my sinful state, there's a part of me that says, her, not me, you know? And but it's a testimony. It may be a testimony to my sinfulness and unworthiness, but it probably is a testimony to the sovereignty of God and how he chooses how he distributes his gifts, no matter what. He has something that he wants to work out. And so I think that healing is possible, profound change is possible for some folks. And I pray as I talk with folks that they'll be open to that. But the reality is, the more I know people who've been in this journey a long, long time, very few of them have had the absolute light switch transformation. Some of them have moved, but many have realized, you know, I'm really in a different place in terms of identity. I really do experience homosexual attraction that's compulsive and difficult to manage much less frequently than I ever did before. I'm in a different place, but I'm not completely healed. And that is just their experience. And so I want to defend the possibility of change, but I also want to say more and more strongly over time the importance of recognizing chastity and the embrace of a disciplined life of giving glory to God through the stewardship of our sexual lives is a place of dignity and something that the church, we really need to work hard to support these folks.
Wait, question? Yeah,
hi there. I had a question, and I guess in asking this, I know you can't, you know, fit all these answers into a little box or anything. But I have a friend, and I think he grew up in the church, and recently he came out as a, you know, openly gay. But in saying that, he also kind of confessed that this has been like his closest time with God, and he, you know, he shares that, oh, in sharing my, you know, sexuality now I feel so free, and he says all these things about him feeling closer to God, and I guess, I don't know, he's just confused or something, and I guess as a friend, like, how do I approach him and kind of walk with him or talk to him?
Mm-hmm. Well, I first of all, when a close friend shares this part of their story with me, you know, I thank them for trusting me with this, because they know I'm a Christian who adheres to a biblical sexual ethic, and so we're going to disagree about that. So I think what a lot of people feel like they need to do is re-articulate that. I would resist that urge. I think sometimes people want to make sure that they're clear on their orthodoxy or something before they can. I think you want to, you know, be in the relationship, thank them for the transparency. What I did with a very close friend of mine is I don't know if this image will be how this will be received here, but I sort of pushed all my chips in with this friend, and I said, "Look, I'm all in with you. You're one of my closest friends, and that's not going to change for what you've shared with me." So what I'm trying to communicate is a sustained presence with this person over time. But we disagree about this, and you know, what's the nature of the disagreement? I mean, I think it's doctrinal error, but I'm concerned about this person's spiritual life. I want to be in a relationship with them where I can continue to kind of walk out, encourage their walk with God. I mean, I'm glad that they feel closer to God. They're attributing that to this newfound freedom in their identity. I might find that I'm closer to God when I'm struggling with things. That's certainly been more my storyline. And so I want to continue to foster their walk with God. And I'm asking the Holy Spirit to speak to that person, to me in this. How do I maintain this kind of a sustained relationship? Those are the kinds of principles I generally follow in that relationship.
Hello, I'm Cameron McGee. And I was just wondering, what are your thoughts on conversion therapy and the position that it can have dangerous consequences?
Yeah. I will speak to that. I feel, frankly, very conflicted about it. I think, unquestionably, the various types of conversion therapies that are offered work with some people some of the time. They fit that person's needs. So, on one level, I want to be a guardian of that as a possible option for people. The claims that it is damaging, I think, are exaggerated, but they are also can be real. There are abusive forms of intervention out there. There have been some very unwise decisions that have been made historically, and so that needs to be acknowledged. But not every form of attempting to change a person's sexual orientation is inherently abusive. What I think we need to be most concerned about, I think, is some of the forms of conversion therapy that are pushed presume that there's one causal pattern that generates all forms of homosexuality, and we know the answer. It's X, Y, and Z, and so if you treat X, Y, and Z in the following format, everybody's going to get better. And it's that kind of, I think, simplistic thinking that is part of the problem with some approaches. And so I think recognizing that the causes of the homosexual condition are ultimately mysterious. I think on the basis of good science, we know that there's some contribution of genetics and biology, but it's not a necessarily overpowering contribution. It's something that contributes to a trajectory in the person's life. We know that there are possible psychological causation factors that are operative for some, but not everybody. Not every male homosexual has a distant, absent father. Not every person comes from a broken family. Not every homosexual person has been subjected to sexual abuse in childhood or adolescence. And so some of the forms that can be damaging are when they assume that this must be true about you, and so if you're not admitting it, you're in denial, and so forth and so on. So I think that that there's value in some of the approaches, and some of them in unquestionably have benefits with certain people, but they need to be handled much more modestly and than how some of them are promoted.
Thank you.
I would say the other piece I think that Stan's commented on is that, so there's a theory of causation, like parent-child relationships, things like that, sexual abuse. But then what some versions of conversion therapy do is they say that if that's addressed, you'll become heterosexual. And so do we really know, first, the causal pathway, and then do we know that if you have a better relationship with a parent or a parent figure, that now you'll become heterosexual? Or if you resolve the negative emotional sequelae from sexual trauma, that you'll now become heterosexual? These are two different claims. One's a claim about a potential pathway, and then one's a claim about potential treatment. And I don't think that the case has been made very strongly that we have consistent answers about causation or consistent outcomes on the other end of things. Now, I do believe in the person's right to self-determination and autonomy to make that choice, but they should do so with what I would call advanced or expanded informed consent, that they know what they're getting into and some of the potential risks that are involved there. And so you see some of the same fighting there that we see with the ministry groups, actually some of the same debates that are happening within our profession.
Thank you.
My question is along the lines of homosexual rights and cultural engagement. And a very popular homosexual argument is that the way the Christian church is opposing homosexuality is equating to the same opposition that happened in regards to slavery and human rights. It's and that the gay rights and the homosexual rights is equating on the human rights, and therefore the Christian church will look back on this and see how foolish they were in opposing homosexual rights, in the same sense that the Christian church looked back on those who opposed the freedom of slavery and the freedom from that. And so how should we as Christians engage in that kind of sense, and when a culture is shifting in so hard that gay right equals racial rights, and yeah, so how do we engage?
Let me, that's a great question, and let me just try to hit real quickly two big picture issues. One is that the idea that sexual orientation is the equivalent of race is really very scientifically suspect, because just the causal patterns are much more cloudy with sexual orientation than it is with race and other identifiable gender and so forth and so on. So that's one issue. I think a second issue is that earlier Darrell was talking about how 50 years ago there was a consensus that homosexuality was a mental illness. It hasn't come out this explicitly, but there's a sense in which it's almost being argued now that opposition to gay rights is a mental illness. Because the terminology of homophobia is a deliberate invocation, and what is being claimed at the broad level is that there is no such thing as a rational objection to same-sex behavior or same-sex orientation. If there's no rational objection, it must be emotional. It must be irrational. And so, even in the court cases, what we're seeing is when arguments are struck down, the terminology the courts are using is this argument is clearly nothing but animus, and animus is hatred, which is irrational. And so the church's arguments are being reduced to pure irrationality. And I think that just because we have moral objections and theological objections doesn't mean that we have irrational objections. So I think that that we need to approach with those things clear in our minds. Now, then as we approach it, I think that one of the things that the church has to debate is, are we going to participate as citizens or not? And there's a sense in which we care about the structure of culture, we care about the formation of culture, so there's a sense in which Christians ought to speak up. But how far do we go in trying to play the political game by today's rules in order to win? And so yesterday at the conference, there was a person who was attending from the Bay Area, and she told us that the gap between the Christian church and the gay community is wider than ever after the Proposition 8 fight because of some of the tactics that some of the Christians played in sort of the advertising game, the lobbying game, frightening people, some of the things that were distributed among the conservative churches that were really scandalous in the claims that they made about the gay and lesbian community and so forth and so on. So I think as Christians we can't withdraw from culture, but before we engage culture, we ought to make sure that the way we're going to engage is rational, that it's winsome, that we've really thought through what level of sort of tactics we're going to use. And I guess my final point would be that we also need to approach this increasingly from the question of the implications for religious liberty. Because I think that Christians, conservative Christians, need to be increasingly concerned about the protection of our religious liberty in this day and age. And the question about the morality of homosexual conduct is in part a religious liberty question. And there's a sense in which if we're going to protect our religious liberty, are we also willing to grant the religious liberty of others to disagree about this fundamental moral question? And so we need to be ready to lose in the question. I think it'll have a negative impact on culture. I believe it's already having a negative impact on culture. But the church is not going to go down the tubes because of that. The church grows, historically has tended to grow under opposition. And so there's a purifying element of that, and so we need to have all those things in mind as we think about how we engage it.
Let me make one observation that's a biblical observation when this question comes up. And that is, if you look at slavery or you look at gender, which are the two categories that this often gets compared to, when you look at scripture, you get passages that talk about becoming free or passages that affirm the role of women. There are positive passages as well as some of the restricting passages. When we come to this area in scripture, the question I like to ask someone who raises this argument is, show me a text in the Bible where this area is handled neutrally or positively. And just name me one. I've done this with people who have argued for a limited same-sex, a monogamous same-sex relationship as being biblical defensible in email exchanges and stuff. And that's the question that I put to them. And the point that I'm trying to make by raising the question that way is that if you look at how Scripture handles these different areas, they aren't compared on an equal plane. They're handled differently. And that's, I think, important to be aware of. Okay, over here.
Same-sex marriage isn't legal here right now. But say it becomes legal in the future, or we minister, become pastors, places where it is legal. What specific challenges come to Christian pastors and leaders in that environment, and how do we deal with those?
Well, your turn.
Yeah.
Is that how this works?
Stan's really gracious.
It would be hard to capture all of the challenges that will come, but I do consult with churches around the country, and I can tell you in some states where marriages are legally recognized, the challenges that come are things that you can sort of imagine. So a same-sex couple that's married has adopted children, or one has children from a previous relationship, and they come to the church, and they're a family now in your church. And they may want to be active participants. They want to take communion. They may want to become members. They want to teach. They want to work in the nursery. So these are just, I think, churches struggle a little bit with where's the line in terms of active membership in a church. Some people set that at membership. Others set that at the level of communion, but then they set membership as a prerequisite for communion. Others have an open table, and they have different challenges with each of those lines that they draw. But then pastorally, what do you do? I mean, are you sitting down with a couple and suggesting that they now end a relationship where they have children now involved? I mean, that's where it starts to get pretty complicated, and many people have pointed out that our culture is going to be increasingly a mission field. Missional models are going to be a consideration, whereas they might not have been before. And on the mission field, sometimes we have not said to people in, relationships with multiple spouses to end all those other relationships when they've had economic consequences for that, for all the people that are involved. And so I think churches are going to have to think more creatively, more missionally about church than we have when we thought about church as just kind of a safe haven for the believers to kind of reside together and then kind of from there launch out into the world. That model is probably not going to be sustainable in a changing culture.
Well, you somewhat just addressed this topic, so an extended answer might be superfluous, but one of my professors, Professor Harrell, brought up a very interesting question that stuck with me in one of our classes. So I'd be interested in hearing you respond to that question, which was, if you were part of the leadership in a church and you had a transgender individual who was desiring to become involved in, say, a women's class, or perhaps they have a partner that they would like to be involved in a couples class that your church is conducting, how would you respond to that situation?
Mm-hmm. I agree that anything at this point would be superfluous. Okay. In a room this size, there's no way that one answer is going to be satisfying to all of us. I think it's a transgender issues is tremendously challenging. It's much more rare than the lesbian, gay, bisexual discussion, for someone to be truly gender dysphoric, where they their psychological sense of their gender identity does not correspond with their biological sex. And it's, in these rare cases, it is often so psychologically debilitating, the person has great risk of significant depression and self-harming, risk of suicide and ideation and action. So I begin in a leadership capacity in a church, thinking about how do I shepherd somebody who is demonstrating to me by word that they have a relationship with Christ, and I'm going to have to go back a few chapters of their life before they got to this point. Now, I've worked with children as young as 4 and 5 years old who met criteria for gender identity disorder, and I've met people in their 50s. Well, most of us may be thinking of a prototypical transsexual person in their 50s. And let me tell you, it helps to have met children who are 6 years old who are gender dysphoric. Because when you meet a 50-year-old, you've got to think about them developmentally. You're reading this chapter of their life and they're asking, can I serve in this capacity? Okay, why don't we meet and talk about some of the chapters I've not been privy to? I would love to hear more about the story that you are, where you have arrived now. I think to react pastorally to chapter 7 when there's 6 chapters that preceded it would be a mistake. Mm-hmm. Tell me about the chapters that have been before, because it's an honor to hear this. And then let's seek together unto what it would mean to be a part of our body, to serve within our community, to grow in greater Christ-likeness. I met one person I know pretty well, shared with me as a Christian, said, I don't know that I did the right thing. She had transitioned, and she said, I may have sinned in what I did. I don't know. What would you have me do now? And that's a very disarming question. I wasn't with her shepherding her on the front end of those decisions. I don't know. Might have been a different kind of discussion. It's a different discussion on the other side of that. And now they want to be in your church. And there's issues in how do we communicate this across generations to people? Are they in a leadership role? What, you know, there's a lot of issues that would come up with that kind of a request that just aren't, I wouldn't be able to do justice to the complexity here. But just to give you a couple of ideas of things that I would do pastorally, those are the direction I'd go.
If I can just add just a quick word, I think that it needs to be said also that the scriptures are, in a sense, crisp and clear about same-sex erotic behavior, that this is something that is condemned. When you move, when you transition into asking questions about transsexuality and gender dysphoria issues and so forth and so on, you're really dealing with principles of scripture rather than these kind of clear commandments. So what, in a sense, what commandment has this person violated? Well, I think as Christians we need to defend the creational dignity of the binary creation of God as male and female. And there's a part of the radical advocacy group in the working with transgenders that actually want to destroy the idea of binary male and female. The next time you take the U.S. census, there will not be 2 categories for sex. There will be 14 or 16. Already in most questionnaires now, SAT and so forth and so on, it's a multiple choice question as to what sex you are. That's the kind of culture that we're headed into. That is those are the realities. I think Christians have a stake in the debate. At one level, it's an empirical reality that there are people who don't clearly fit those 2 categories. There are physical conditions, but there's also a conceptual question. Is that in a sense, not the way God intended? Is that a disordered part of the world that still doesn't undermine the idea that there are fundamentally 2 sexes, male and female? So we have to keep that in mind. And so when this person comes forward who has taken this radical step, to the best of my discernment, God would not have had them that didn't please God that they took that step. But was it actively a sin? Are they in a sense lost forever to the church? How do I deal with this person? That's where I think hearing their story, understanding how they made the decisions, understanding exactly where they are in their spiritual journey right now, gives you a chance to speak into their lives in a way that's deeper and more satisfying.
Okay, we'll probably have time for one more question right here.
My question is, if we hold that homosexuals should primarily see their identity in Christ and remain celibate as a result of that, and since the church today seems to focus a lot on marriage and the family, how can we restructure the church and its ministries or programs so that homosexuals who do, in fact, follow, you know, in celibacy and seeing their identity primarily in Christ can be active and fulfilled members in the church? That's my question.
Yeah, it is a restructuring, isn't it? I appreciate what you're saying. I think the place to begin is with a bit more compassion for the costly obedience of what celibacy would represent to somebody. Most of us just by count would probably not fully appreciate what that means for somebody, okay, to think about lifelong celibacy. There's a costly obedience there. Then the question I ask for myself is, in what way am I living into costly obedience in my life? Because the perception is that I'm not, and that I'm asking them to do so. And so then it seems like a fundamentally unjust arrangement. And so, and there may be things that just are different that way, but I am challenged as a Christian in the West, the American Christian, in my view, from a global perspective, does not typically live into costly obedience the way Christians globally live into costly obedience. And now I'm asking someone to do that in their area of sexuality in a sexually saturated culture. So, okay, kinship. I mean, it may be radical things. It may be easy things. It may be, I want you to, you know, we've offered to have people stay in our home, live with us. Do they have vacation plans? Do they have things that they do with family? A kinship network would be like treating someone like their family to you. Now, I didn't fully appreciate kinship networks until I was part of a multi-ethnic church where, for me, family was a core group of five people that I was raised in. And it's a very limited view of a close family. But I have a greater appreciation for kinship ties across relationships with people that might mean inviting people to come on vacation, inviting people to live in my home. It would be kind of that scenario rather than, you know, the idea that I'm going home to my wife and they're going home to nobody, and I'm just saying, you know, good luck with that celibacy. I mean, I don't, that is a very shallow way. I'll be praying for you is not the response for the church right now. Mm-hmm. And then I think we often present them with the romantic fantasy that our marriages are great. Well, our marriages are challenging. And I don't know that single people committed to celibacy fully understand the challenges of being married as well. And so it is a great gift and a good blessing, but I think sometimes we portray it in a very romanticized way for people, and that probably creates a contrast effect for them that makes their situation feel even worse.
Well, let's thank Mark and Stan for their time. And let me close this in a word of prayer. Let's pray. Our Father, we do know that we live in a world that needs you. We all need you. We all need you for different reasons, and we all need you for the same reason. You are our Creator. You are our Father. You are the one who has made and shaped us in your image. Our prayer is a simple one, and yet it is profound. Draw us closer to yourself. And help us to be the reflection of light that you've called us to be. Help us to live wisely in the tensions that come from living in a fallen world. And help us to remember that we are all recipients of your grace. And we are all beneficiaries of your grace. Help us to reflect that in the way we treat those around us. May we love you with our heart, mind, and soul. And may we love our neighbor well. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.